Us in the studio to talk about their relief efforts are U.S. Ambassador to the Philippines Harry Thomas, USAID Mission Director Gloria Steele, Lieutenant Colonel Jason Julian, and Colonel Mark J. Minoli. Good morning, and thank you very much for joining us here in the studio. Ambassador, I would like to thank you for your help to the victims of Typhoon Pablo and for the additional funds, which is worth $3 million on top of the funds you already gave us.
Well, thank you for having us, and our condolences, thoughts, and prayers go out to all the victims. We don't forget that just a few weeks ago, the Philippine government so generously donated to the victims of Hurricane Sandy, which include my mother. So I was personally very, very moved. But I want to say that we've been working shoulder to shoulder, hand to hand with our Philippine colleagues and in the Philippine military, non-governmental organizations, and the government. We've trained for years with the Philippine military. We were able to provide this assistance because of the Visiting Forces Agreement and the Mutual Defense Treaty. But I'd like to clear up one thing you said. We move pretty fast in the U.S. government. And our donations now will be over 400 million pesos.
Just for the Pablo-affected areas?
Pablo-affected areas.
400 million pesos.
That's right.
Okay, thank you very
so
much.
So we have, you weren't incorrect, we've just augmented it. And we're responding to the Philippine government request last night. We're going to do search and rescue for those Mindanao fishermen that you just said were
missing.
That's right.
And we have to clarify that it's not just funding that we're getting from the U.S. government, but also training, relief assistance, and as you mentioned, the rescue efforts for those more than 300 fishermen who are still missing.
Yes, our USAID Office of Foreign Direct Disaster Assistance, the United States military, in this case led by the United States Marine Corps, are here to help. We're also providing assistance to non-governmental organizations such as Catholic Relief Services and the World Food Program. But I want to emphasize this is under the direction of the Philippine government. We work hand in hand with them. But we've always helped the Philippines. We always will in these cases.
Again, thank you very much. Ms. Gloria of USAID was able to visit a number of the towns that were badly affected. What was the situation there on the ground?
Well, let me correct that. I was not able to gain access, but my staff are were able to visit Baganga, Katiil.
And what were the stories that you
they
received?
They were really very sad stories. It's about stories of mothers looking for their children, children looking for their parents. And but the most important part of it was that there's a lot of hope. There continues to be a lot of hope among those that they talk to. I think hope that help will come and we'll be able to identify and find their relatives. So this is very encouraging for us as we move forward. The hope is not gone.
And it's nice to know that there are more relief efforts, relief goods coming into those towns that were previously isolated. Of course, with the help of USAID, those relief goods that you have been giving us has been augmenting the supplies that they've been receiving from the national government. Lieutenant Colonel Jason Julian was able to fly over those areas.
I have. We've flown about 12 missions down there since we arrived here on Saturday, and the scope of the devastation on the island itself is really something to see. The entire area, you could tell, was affected by the typhoon.
And Colonel Mark?
So what I wanted to let you know is that just about 2 weeks ago, less than that, during the week of when the typhoon was actually coming through, we were in the process of doing a Balikatan final planning conference. So with our partners in the AFP, we already started to kind of look at this problem as it was coming through, and through those established relationships, we're able to kind of formulate a quick plan and to go ahead and push some of that what might be needed, what we thought initially, and because again, the forward stationing of U.S. forces, particularly Marine forces on Okinawa, Japan, respond relatively quickly to the disaster.
Okay, going back to the USAID, how much help have you given to those badly affected areas?
Well, we have, you know, helped in the water, providing water, sanitation. Just recently, on Monday, we had plastic sheeting for emergency shelter that we flew in from Dubai, and that should provide for 20,000 families. as soon as we're working with the Philippine government to find out when we can come in and help with restarting up the health, water, energy.
Which is something that is badly needed right
now. And that's right, and livelihood. But we're working with the Philippine government in doing this. In the meantime, we're assessing the situation on for the recovery, the post-emergency phase of this process.
And gentlemen, go ahead.
And we stand ready to provide in that.
Thank you very much. And gentlemen, you have been also assisting in the relief efforts. I believe it wasn't just a flyover to assess the damage, but you have already also dropped relief goods in some areas. Is that correct?
Going down into Davao, we've delivered over 33,300 pounds of relief supplies down there, over 12 missions. And that's been really the eye-opening part for me. Besides just the devastation down there, seeing the scale of the relief efforts of the Philippine Army, Navy, Marines, Air Force, right beside our own Marines, Air Force, Army, and Navy personnel, building the logistics supplies here to go on the planes, and then quickly offloading them down there. It's been very good to see.
Mm-hmm. Colonel Mark.
Again, just probably, we did establish a bilateral coordination center out of Villamar Air Base, so with our AFP counterparts, also interagency USAID present, Jesotef P folks who are down in Davao area, and able to facilitate the coordination that's required to push those supplies down.
Mm-hmm. Okay, this is, if we go a step back, we're just talking about Pablo-affected areas, but the Philippines, a number of storms would pass the Philippines within a year. There has been a lot of developments with regard to upgrading equipment and getting people ready, and local governments and the National Disaster Risk Reduction Management Council, and coordinating everything whenever a calamity would hit. But there is still some room for development. Is the U.S. government ready to also still assist us?
We're doing that.
Yes, you are.
USAID is working in Cagayan de Oro, Batangas, and Davao. I'll let Ms. Steele amplify that. Mm-hmm. We're going to help the first responders. We're going to help with urban planning. We understand this is a long-term challenge that we face. Mm-hmm. But Ms. Steele is well briefed on that.
Ms. Loya?
Yes, we have looked at the most disaster-prone areas in the country and have begun to work with the local communities on what they call disaster risk reduction efforts.
Yes.
And these are efforts that are intended to minimize the impact and make the infrastructure more disaster-ready. And to this effect, we allocated about 168 million pesos this year alone. And we look forward to putting in more.
But these are just for those areas that are regularly hit by typhoons. So we're talking about Mindanao now. Are you going to give additional assistance and training to those people as well now that it has been, well, it was rare before the typhoons would hit that part of the country, but seems to be becoming more often.
That's right. And the ambassador just approved a strategy where one of our three top priorities is disaster risk reduction, so we can cover more areas in the country to be able to do that. We immediately went to Cagayan because of Sendong last year, but we are going to expand this now and allocate more of our resources to do just that. We're also working with PAGASA in order to enable them to forecast earlier, and just a broad range of assistance in order to minimize the negative impact of natural calamities. I understand about 1% of GDP each year is lost because of natural calamities, and there are ways that we can minimize this. We can't control the calamities from happening, but we can minimize the impact, the negative impact, and that's what we're focused on.
The Balikatan exercises is not only focused on the national defense, but also on training people for disaster preparedness.
That's correct. In fact, this coming one, we're planning on doing a humanitarian assistance disaster relief scenario. We just also completed something called FIBLEX, an amphibious exercise in October, again with our AFP counterparts, and that focus was in Westcom area, which is Palawan, and we did another humanitarian assistance disaster relief planning exercise. So that's become more of a focus lately.
Okay, with the I was talking to you a while ago and telling you that in the press conference yesterday, it was Secretary Almendras, who was saying that this is going to be a sustained relief effort. This is not going to be fixed in a couple of weeks, maybe in a couple of months. But and some of you, Lieutenant Colonel, was saying that areas have been devastated, posts have been down, infrastructure is down, no source of livelihood, food and water for the residents. Looking forward, what should our country be doing, and what can you assist us in being ready for those disasters and doing something for our countrymen?
Well, I'm not sure who that's directed.
Well, I thought you were asking the colonel, but first of all, we are working, as I said, with the Philippine government. We remain in constant contact with them, but we have short-term, medium-term, and long-term plans to help them mitigate against this, to work with the first responders, work with the NGOs, and work with the government, train the local residents, and we understand that this is something that we must do. And the U.S. military will always be here, Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance, if needed. But it is important and essential that Filipinos learn to do this for themselves. And that's what we're trying to do. And that's one of the things that's coming out of Balikatan and Fiblex, where we're doing the humanitarian exercises. But as Ms. Steele said, we're not just working in Mindanao. Batangas is also one of our target cities, and we'll look for more in the future.
Okay, Ambassador Harry Thomas, Ms. Gloria Steele, Lieutenant Colonel Jason Julian, and Colonel Mark Minotti, thank you very much for joining us here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Egyptians begin voting on a disputed draft constitution, and Kapamilya star Jesse Mendiola is open to accepting projects in Korea. Stay tuned. You're watching Mornings at 8.